Well, good morning and welcome to the service of worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Join us in our opening hymn this morning, number 2212, My Life Flows On. Thank you for all the wonderful work that moms do, and just have a moment of honor and a tribute, and we will have that later in the service. One thing, I just want to give an update on where I'm at in my seminary journey. So this was my last week of class, and I turned in most of my assignments. I just have two small things left, and then I will be done with my third year. That means I just have one left, but this last year is a lot. My course load's about half, so I'm way open, and I can see the end in sight. So I just want to say thank you for all the support of everyone who's been a part of that, and for all your prayers and good wishes and all those things. So thank you very much. One other thing that, since we are not been able to meet in person, is we have our noisy offering. This, especially here at Asbury, the children collect the noisy offering, and in Northwood, all the coins go to the share shop. And so I found these in my office here at Asbury, and they're these little boxes, and maybe you remember these as a kid. This one says my Advent gift on it, but I think we can use this as a way to collect our coins, and then when we come back together, then we can present all of them. So what I'm going to do is leave some of these here at Asbury by the double doors on the, what side is that church? The east side. Yeah, the east side of the church, by the double doors. And same thing in Northwood, at those double doors that lead up to the office, so just have them right there. For those that might want to come and grab those and be a reminder to to save our change. And then when we come back together, we can present all those as our noisy offering and our change for God. All right, well, let us go in prayer this morning. God, we once again lift up all those who are affected by this virus. And Lord, those that are maybe struggling with loneliness or depression or other things, we lift them up to you right now. And Lord, we ask that you just be with them. Lord, be a comfort and a peace. And Lord, be a healer to those that are suffering and hurting. And Lord, for those that are on the front lines, Lord, those essential workers and those in the hospitals and clinics and other things, we ask for a hedge of protection around them. Keep them safe as they are doing their job and doing their best effort to come through this. And Lord, I just ask for wisdom for our leaders, Lord, for our governors and for the president and for all those who are making these tough decisions, and for school administrators trying to find out ways to do graduation and all those. We ask for clearness of thought and wisdom to find the right answers, the right for all these things. And we ask all this in your name. Amen. Amen. Our hymn of praise this morning is Gather Us In, number 2236. Let us join together.
Under heaven.
We are all God's offspring.
Search for God in our time of worship.
When we search, we find God here.
Hear our prayers, O God, as we come to sing your praises. Bless us with your steadfast love in times of peace and in times of trial. Make your presence known to us this day, for we seek to know you better. Enliven us with your spirit of truth and increase our faith, even as we place our hope and trust in you. Amen. For our special moments, Brad is going to sing a song in honor of our graduates and our moms called Always Be a Child.
This is a song about how parents feel about their children, how mothers feel about their children, and as parents have graduating seniors, how they feel about their children, but also about how our Heavenly Father feels about all of us. I was there when you drew the breath of life, and I could hear your voice the first time that you cried. And though you couldn't see me, I was very near. And there's something now that I want you to hear. You will always be a child in my eyes. And when you need some love, my arms are open wide. And even when you're growing old, I hope you realize you will always be a child in my eyes. I was there the first time that you prayed, and I heard all the promises you made. And when you fell before me, crying, Father, I have sinned, I picked you up and held you close again. You will always be a child in my eyes. And when you need some love, my arms are open wide. And even when you've grown old, I hope you realize you will always be a child in my eyes. You will always be a child in my eyes. And when you need some love, my arms are open wide. And even when you're growing old, I hope you realize you will always be a child in my eyes. You will always be a child in my eyes.
Well, hello, boys and girls.
I thought I'd do something a little different for our children's message today. And so I'm actually here at our hobby farm, and I'm with my llama, Sterling. He's one of six llamas that we have. And I figure most of you have probably never seen a llama or been around one before, so I thought this would be a good opportunity to talk about him. So as you can see, Sterling, he likes to eat grass and flowers and other things like that. Like to eat leaves on the trees. And so notice that he's very woolly. He's got very soft wool. And a lot of people think alpacas and llamas are the same, but they're actually not. They're different. They're in the same family, the camelid family. So llamas are in the same family as camels and alpacas, and gauchos are the other one. The difference between llamas and alpacas is that alpacas are a lot smaller and their face a lot smaller. So if you look at Sterling's face, that kind of longer face, alpacas is a lot more smushed in. And Sterling is probably my favorite llama because he was actually born here. Sterling has lived here his whole life, and we were camping one summer, and Carter and I came home to do chores, and there's this little baby running around, and we didn't even know that his mother was pregnant with him. And so Sterling has been a part of our family ever since. And llamas are a lot of fun. But God created llamas. He created all those creatures, and he made llamas so that they can survive in the winter. We don't really need to do anything special. They just their wool grows out, and they're able to survive. They are able to find water, and they eat, and God provides all those things for them. And so just the amount of detail that God created in llamas and other animals that they can survive just shows the care and the love. So all creatures, great and small, our God loves and created them all. And you know what? That's us as well. God loves us and created us as well. We are made in the image of God. So I encourage you today that if you have a furry friend you love, to give them a hug. Oh, thanks, Sterling. Give them a hug and enjoy all of God's creation. So take care, God bless, and love one another. See you next time.
Our scripture reading today is 1 Samuel chapter 15. Please join me at home with your own Bible, if you will. Starting with verse 1. Samuel said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you over his people Israel. Listen now to the Lord's words. This is what the Lord of heavenly forces says. I am going to punish the Amalekites for what they did to Israel, how they attacked the Israelites as they came up from Egypt. So go, attack the Amalekites. Put everything that belongs to them under the ban. Spare no one. Kill men and women, children and infants, oxen, sheep, camels, and donkeys." Saul called out the troops and counted them at Telaim, 200,000 foot soldiers and 10,000 more troops from Judah. Then Saul advanced on the Amalekite city and laid an ambush in the valley. Saul told the Kenites, "Get going, leave the Amalekites immediately, because you showed kindness to the Israelites when they came out of Egypt. Otherwise, I'll destroy you right along with them." So the Kenites left the Amalekites. Then Saul attacked the Amalekites from Havilah all the way to Shur, which is near Egypt. He captured Agag, the Amalekite king, alive, but Saul placed all the people under the ban, killing them with the sword. Saul and the troops spared Agag along with the best sheep, cattle, fattened calves, lambs, and everything of value. They weren't willing to put them under the ban, but anything that was despised or of no value, they placed under the ban. Then the Lord's word came to Saul, or Samuel. "I regret making Saul king because he has turned away from following me and hasn't done what I said." Samuel was upset at this, and he prayed to the Lord all night long. Samuel got up early in the morning to meet Saul and was told, "Saul went to Carmel, where he is setting up a monument for himself." Then he left and went down to Gilgal. When Samuel reached Saul, Saul greeted him. "The Lord bless you. I've done what the Lord said." "Then what," Samuel asked, "is the bleating of the sheep in my ears and the mooing of cattle that I hear?" "They were taken from the Amalekites," Saul said, "because the troops spared the best sheep and cattle in order to sacrifice them to the Lord your God. The rest was placed under the ban." Samuel then said to Saul, "Enough. Let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night." "Well, tell me," Saul replied. Samuel said, "Even if you think you are insignificant, aren't you the leader of Israel's tribes? The Lord anointed you king over Israel. The Lord sent you on a mission, instructing you, go and put the sinful Amalekites under the ban. Fight against them until you've wiped them out. Why didn't you obey the Lord? You did evil in the Lord's eyes when you tore into that plunder.
But I obeyed the Lord, Saul protested to Samuel. I went on the mission the Lord sent me on. I captured Agag, the Amalekite king, and I put the Amalekites under the ban.
Yes, the troops took the sheep and cattle from the plunder, the very best items they placed under the ban, but in order to sacrifice them to the Lord your God at Gilgal.
And Samuel replied, does the Lord want entirely burned offerings and sacrifices, as much as obedience to the Lord? Listen to this. Obeying is better than sacrificing. Paying attention is better than fat from rams, because rebellion is as bad as the sin of divination. Arrogance is like the evil of idolatry. Because you have rejected what the Lord said, he has rejected you as king.
Saul said to Samuel, I've sinned because I disobeyed the Lord's command and your instructions. I was afraid of the troops and obeyed them, but now please forgive my sin. Come back with me so I can worship the Lord.
But Samuel said to Saul, I can't return with you because you have rejected what the Lord said, and the Lord has rejected you from being king over Israel.
Samuel turned to leave, but Saul grabbed the edge of his robe and it ripped. Then Samuel told him, the Lord has ripped the kingdom of Israel from you today. He would give it to a friend of yours, someone who is more worthy than you. What's more, the enduring one of Israel doesn't take back what he says and doesn't change his mind. He is not a human being who could change his mind.
Then Saul said, please honor me and before Israel. Come back with me so I can worship the Lord your God.
So Samuel went back with Saul, and Saul worshiped the Lord.
Bring me Agag, the Amalekite king, Samuel said. Agag came to him in chains, asking, would death have been as bitter as this is?
Samuel said, just as your sword left women without their children, now your mother will be childless among women.
Then Samuel cut Agag into pieces in the Lord's presence at Gilgal.
Then Samuel went to Ramah, but Saul went up to his home in Gibeah. Samuel never saw Saul again before he died, but he grieved over Saul. However, the Lord regretted making Saul king over Israel.
Now, this is one of these passages in the Bible that just makes our skin crawl. To think that the idea of God commanding Saul to kill women, men, children, infants, and all the other animals. I mean, this does not sound like the God whose love is unconditional and who sent Jesus to die on our behalf. Is this a God who's full of mercy and grace? Yet, here it is. It's in our Bible. So what do we do with this chapter? Now, I could have easily skipped over this and not even mentioned it, because the next chapter is about David being anointed as the next king. That's real easy to preach on. I'm going to get to that, but I could easily skip that. But I didn't want to, because that goes against why I'm even doing this series. Because there are these passages in the Bible. There are these things that make us question, what is going on? Why? Why would God have that in there? Why would God want them to do that? We need to wrestle with these things. And so I'm going to suggest that we do what a friend and colleague of mine, Dana, does. Is she has this bucket that she says she puts those things in, but she doesn't know how she can reconcile that or how she feels about it. So she puts those things in a bucket, and then she can go back to it later. You don't want to just cast it out or not even look at it, but kind of put it off to the side and then maybe come back to that later. So if we put aside this whole thing for a moment and look at this difficult text and see why would that be there? Because if we try to cut those things out that we don't agree with or don't like in the Bible, then that starts to set a bad precedent. And I want us to have a full understanding of the Bible. And those things in the Old Testament, why they're there. So then why this holy war? Why this issue that God would have them do this? Well, to understand that, we need to know why the Amalekites? What was the issue with the Amalekites that brought them up? What did they do to Israel? Well, the answer to this question is found actually in Exodus chapter 17. If we go back to that, when the Israelites were just being freed as slaves in Egypt and they were wandering in the desert, the Amalekites came and attacked them. And this is the story of where Moses tells Joshua to go and lead the troops into battle against the Amalek and the Amalekites, and where Moses goes up on top of the hill, and Aaron and Hur are there with him. And as long as Moses held up his staff, the Israelites were winning. But if he got fatigued and his arms would drop, then they would start to lose, and the Amalekites would start to win. So Aaron and Hur got on both sides of Moses and propped up his arms. And a battle went on. They helped Moses hold his arms up in the air so the Israelites could win that victory. And then at the end of this battle, in verses 14 and 16 in Exodus, this is the key to our text here in 1 Samuel. This is the key of what it says. The Lord said to Moses, "Write this as a reminder on a scroll and read it to Joshua. I will completely wipe out the memory of Amalek under the sky." Moses then built an altar there and called it, "The Lord is my banner." For he said, "The power of the Lord's banner. The Lord is at war with Amalek in every generation." What does that mean, in every generation, the Lord is at war with Amalek? Well, we see that here in what's going on here. The Lord is at war with him. And then if you go to the book of Esther, there's a man in there named Haman. Haman was actually an Amalekite. And what did Haman want to do? He wanted to get rid of all the Jews. And so he built these large set of gallows. I was going to hang them all on it. But then Haman is the one who ends up getting hung on the noose. So we see this, that there's always this war between the Amalekites. And what this does is it actually speaks of covenant. Remember, God made a covenant with Abraham. He promised Abraham that he would be a father of a great nation. God makes this covenant with Abraham. And then again with Moses. And the covenant is, "I will be the Lord your God, and you will be my people." So when the Amalekites attacked the Israelites, in a sense, they were exactly attacking God. And God was not going to stand for that. So we need to keep that in the back of our mind when we go through these passages, is that not to think of it in terms of today, but think of it as what that meant back then, this idea of covenant. And remember, this is the old covenant that they're under. When Jesus came, he says, "I'm going to establish a new covenant with you in my blood." That's the new covenant that Jesus came to establish with us. We're not under that old covenant anymore, but the new covenant. That through the shed blood of Christ, we receive that forgiveness of sin. We receive that relationship with God. Jesus' blood restores that separation from us and God to where we can be in right relationship again. And so they're under the old covenant in this, and we are under this new covenant. So keep that idea of covenant in mind as we continue through this. So I addressed the why God would want them to go after the Amalekites. Now let's look at the what. And so in verse 3, God tells Saul to put them under the ban. Or that word in Hebrew is harem. Basically that meant that everything was to be sacrificed. A total annihilation, destruction. And so Saul's troops set out and they were going to do exactly what God commanded. But does Saul actually do exactly what God commanded? No. No, and yes, he was supposed to wipe out everyone, but yet he captured the king alive. And basically everything of value, they kept. The best of the sheep, the cattle, the fatted calves, the lambs, all those things. They kept all the things of value. And anything that was worthless or of no value, that's what they put under the ban. No, Saul did not follow. Now, did he not do it because of some moral objection? Like, "Oh, I just can't do it, and so I'm not going to do that. I can't get rid of everybody. I would just feel horrible if I did that." Was that why? No, because when Samuel goes to find him, what's he doing? He's building a monument to himself. He's celebrating the victory and building a monument to himself. If this was today, Saul would be down there taking selfies with all the stuff around him. So it doesn't sound like someone who's remorseful or ashamed of himself or anything like that. No, it's the exact opposite. And so Samuel hears from God that Saul does not do what I asked him to. And so Samuel in this is really the voice of God. Samuel represents God in the story. So he goes to meet Saul. Saul greets him and says, "Hey, guess what? I did exactly what God said." And Samuel's like, "You did, huh? Well, then why is it that I hear sheep baaing and goats bleating over here. Why do I hear all that stuff? I just imagine this scene that he's there and he's saying, oh, I did everything I told you to. And then around the corner, you can hear, like, yeah, okay, well, then why am I hearing all this stuff? You did exactly what you're supposed to. And finally, Samuel's like, okay, enough. I don't want to listen to any more of this. I'm going to tell you what the Lord told me last night. So I was like, okay, well, let me hear it. And he tells him all of these things, and basically that God is happy with you because you did not follow everything that you're supposed to. And he tries to justify it and say, well, no, I did it and everything. And he tries to stick with his guns, and he says that he obeyed the Lord, and he put everything under the ban. But it was the troops. It was the troops that saved those animals. It was the troops that saved those. And the reason they saved them, though, was because they were going to make a sacrifice to the Lord. That's why. They saved them because they want to save the best for God. That's why they did all that. So it wasn't my fault. But then listen to Samuel's response to this. Do you think the Lord wants entirely burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as the Lord wants obedience? Listen to this. Obeying is better than sacrificing. Paying attention is better than fat from rams. Because rebellion is as bad as the sin of divination, arrogance is like the evil of idolatry. And because you've rejected what the Lord said, he is rejecting you as king. This idea of obedience being better than sacrifices. And Saul tries to apologize and try to make up for what he has done. But Samuel says that he must leave because God has rejected him as king. And as Samuel turns to go away, Saul reaches out and he grabs his robe and tears it. I just see that, like, he's saying, okay, enough with you and I'm leaving. It's like, no, wait. And he reaches out and he grabs it and he tears his robe. This causes Samuel to take it to the next level. And he uses that analogy to tell Saul again, guess what? You ripped part of this. God is ripping away the kingdom from you. So this is strike two for Saul. Strike one would have been a few chapters back when he made that unlawful sacrifice. He was impatient and didn't want to wait for Samuel, and so he made a sacrifice to the Lord in hopes of winning this battle. And in doing so, he overstepped his authority. As a king, he was supposed to lead the armies. The priest, Samuel, was supposed to do that, and he was trying to usurp that authority in doing so. So that was strike one. Now Saul's at strike two. Yet, even before he leaves, even with Samuel being as mad as he is at Saul, Saul wanted to try to make amends. And so they go and they offer a sacrifice together and they pray to the Lord. So, in conclusion to this, I want to go back to that phrase, obedience is better than sacrifices. Let that sit with you for a minute. What that might mean for us. You know, it was awfully easy for Saul to try and justify his actions by keeping those choice best animals, to say, well, I was going to do that and give them to the Lord. I was going to make an offering up to the Lord. I mean, after all, God did require the best animals for sacrifices. He didn't want the worst. No, he wanted the best. We give God the best. And it becomes easy for us, too, sometimes to justify our actions in a similar manner. You know, God requires us to love the Lord our God and to love our neighbor. But you know what? It's so much easier just to write a check. It's so much easier just to write a check than it is to love one another. Or to say that, you know, God won't mind if I do this, whatever that might be. If I make it up and, you know what, maybe I serve it for the next two funerals, or I work whatever dinner, or I do all these extra things. You know, I can justify this behavior if I do one of these other things. It becomes easy to justify our actions as if somehow we're trying to keep score. We do enough things to get on God's good side and it overcomes these other things. Yet that's not what God wants. God wants our obedience because it shows
that we have trust in the Lord. It's that idea of faith. We think so many times that faith is just a belief, but no, faith is so much more than that. It's the trust. Obedience and trust is the faith in the Old Testament of what we see in the New Testament. And faith is more than a belief. It's also based on our actions of that belief. So trust in the Lord and obey in God's commands. And then in doing so, we see that God will send down a blessing. God will send a blessing if we do that. If we follow after God, serve the Lord with all our heart, and love our neighbor as ourselves. Those are the two greatest commandments in the Bible. We do those things, then God will bring down a blessing for us in doing so. Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. God, help us to wrestle with these texts that, Lord, sometimes just make no sense. We can't understand them or we struggle with those. Help us to have knowledge and understanding. And Lord, what from that we can glean back for us. Lord, in your promises that you give to us, Lord, let us trust in those. Let us follow and obey those things. Give us a heart of love for you and love for others. Let us continue the work that you have started in this place. Your great mission, Lord, let us be partakers of that. Let us share in that we can share in the feast. Lord, that we can share in the love and the joy and all those things. And in doing so, Lord, we will make a difference in this community. We will make a difference in our families and those around and beyond us that we don't even know we have an impact on. Lord, I ask you, watching and listening to this, Lord, that you will work in their hearts right now. Lord, come and move upon them. Make them real in a mighty way like they have never felt before. Lord, fill this community, this place with your love and power and knowledge and presence. And Lord, give us that hope that there is a brighter day coming our way. And Lord, we ask all these things and we lift them up to you as we pray the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know, we had a message on trusting and obeying, and so our next song follows along with that. Number 467, Trust and Obey. Join with us in this song.
Favor me.
Now let us go in the name of God, the one who created all the nations of the earth. Let us go in the name of Christ, the one who abides in love and abides in you. And go in the name of the Spirit of truth, the one who advocates for you and guides you. Let us go in peace. Amen.